गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन, आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर टुडेज टॉक द आर्ट ऑफ पब्लिक स्पीकिंग बाय मिस्टर हरीश पीके. आई शुड शेयर दैट वी हैव हैड हिम इन अनदर प्रोग्राम इन जनवरी 2013. दैट वॉज ऑल्सो हिट. इट वॉज अ वेरी गुड लेक्चर बाय सर, सो वी हैव कॉल्ड हिम अगेन फॉर द बेनिफिट ऑफ द स्टूडेंट्स. सो I would like to introduce our club Santulan. You may be well aware of it by now. However, since our name has changed from Dhruva to Santulan, I would like to introduce it. Our motto is synergizing hands, heads and hearts. Formerly we were known as Dhruva with running name of Reflections Dhruva. Dhruva was an acronym which stood for determined, hardworking, responsible, unique, virtuous and ambitious students. And then our motto was building and blending character with competence. So now our name has changed to Santulan and our motto now is synergizing hands, heads and hearts. Hands stand for skills, heads for intellect and hearts for intention. So our motto is to synergize, that is to culture, hearts, that is character, with hands and heads, that is competence. So when previous year when sir had come, our name was Reflections Dhruva, now it's Santulan. So our key aims are, we organize forums to educate and expose students to skills, values and knowledge in the principle-centered leadership. We also organize events like debates, design competition, concerts, movie screenings, dramas with the theme of character and culture. We have aimed to empower students in science, technology, soft skills, management, etc., so as to form a holistic and complete leader. We also discuss current scientific contemporary issues which affect our worldview and thereby the culture, like eco-friendly farming, non-biodegradable waste. We also organize programs related to lifestyle and healthcare. We would also like to coordinate with other college or non-college clubs and organizations in the fulfillment of our aims. We have conducted over 24 events in the last 3 years, including the two-day mega event called YES, Youth Empowerment Solutions, in September 2012, which was well attended by over 2,000 students in total. We proud ourselves as one of the fastest growing clubs in the institute's history. Several professors have heartily appreciated our many programs, and we feel proud that two professors are amidst us, Professor BVS Prasad and Professor MP Mahia. We welcome you, sir. Our attendance, average attendance in talks has been over 120, and average attendance in concerts that we have organized has been over 1200. In this present semester itself, we have organized 3 talks. One was Power of Habits, another Shine with 9, and another Never Say Never Again. Shine with 9 was attended by around 240 students, and Never Say Never Again was attended by around 140 students. Shine with 9 was to help students, especially first years, to do good in academics. And it was, the theme was how to get a good CGPA, which is 9, over 9. And Never Say Never Again was about the neurological perspective of happiness. Professor Lakshmi Narasimhan is DM Neurology. So this is our 4th program, and we welcome you for today's talk on the art of public speaking. Today's program flow will be seminar by the speaker, then there will be a short QA session, and meanwhile feedback forms would be distributed to you all. Kindly fill it. Your feedback is very important to us. And then there will be Thanksgiving session, short Thanksgiving session. So let me introduce today's speaker. Today's speaker is Mr. Harish PK. He is presently Senior Design Engineer at Cosmic Circuits in Bangalore. He is alumnus of NIT Suratkal. He has been guiding youth since last 6 years. He has delivered motivational talks at various institutes, including IIT Madras and other institutes like PESET and RV College in Bangalore, Indian Institute of Sciences, NIT Suratkal, etc. The last program that he had given at IIT Madras was in January 2013 with title Mad in New Year, Make a Difference in New Year. We had skit, talk and poem with music in that event. I would request today's speaker, Mr. Harish PK, to kindly share his views on today's topic.
Firstly, very good evening to one and all present here. I would like to sincerely thank every one of you for giving your valuable time and making your presence here. And I hope that I will be able to serve all of you and make justification for all the time what you have spent. Also, we have senior people here. I'm like an ignorant child in front of all of them. So if you find something inappropriate, kindly forgive me and consider that as one of my shortcomings. If there is any credit, it is all to the seniors who have been guiding me for years together. So again, thank you very much for making your presence felt here. There is a very nice thing I thought of to share first before I begin the talk. Like when I was going through the motto or some of the aims and objectives of Santulan, I got an interesting incident to my memory. Like one of the things was to harmonize technology and science for a better world. That is what it meant. I may not be able to verbatim say it, but one of the goals of Santulan is to harmonize this world so that with all the science and technology, we actually engineer out a better world, is it not? So I was just remembering 3 weeks back, I work in Cadence or Cosmic Circuits as a senior design engineer. We had a 2 hours discussion, and the discussion was on how to reduce the jitter, or you can put it in simpler terms, the delay of an inverter by 1 picosecond. What was the discussion? It was a 2 hours meeting on how to reduce the delay of an inverter by 1 picosecond. So of course the meeting was well attended by many seniors in the company, and I was also part of the discussion. Then after the whole meeting was over, I just made a comment to them, and they all also appreciated it. So I told them, we are so eager in saving 1 picosecond, but after saving 1 picosecond, we do not know what to do with the rest of our lives. Is it not true? We have directed missiles in the modern days, but misdirected minds and misdirected hearts. So I feel that the Santulan Club is doing a tremendous job, because what is the use of being on a very big nice ship if the ship doesn't have a mariner's compass, is it not? Because the purpose or the most important commodity of any ship is the mariner's compass, which can give direction. And I feel extremely fortunate, because there is a shloka in the Bhagavad Gita which says, Yadyad acharati shreshtas tattat eve tarojana sayat pramanam kurute lokastat anuvartate. What does this mean? This means whatever a great person does, he sets the trend for the whole of the society. And many of them, seeing his example, take to the same kind of path. So I feel very privileged that I am amongst the most intellectual people here in the Indian Institute of Technology. And I feel that it is very important we, along with the technological advancement and scientific advancement, are very clear on what is the direction we want the world to go in, is it not? Because on one hand, we are going and taking technology to newer and newer levels, but if we can also channelize them in a direction where it can really do good to the society, that will be a great achievement. And I feel that Santulan will help us in realizing this aim, because one more example what I usually quote is, technology is meant to make life better. That is the only purpose of technology. But when character is missing, then that same technology becomes a source of hazard for many of the people. For example, I often ask this question. Many of you are in computer science probably, is it not? We have all heard that cryptography is a very popular field in computer science, is it not? Cryptography. What is cryptography? It means developing algorithms to prevent hacking of the system, is it not? So a question which can be asked is, why has this cryptography become so popular? The obvious answer is because there are so many hackers. And now the next question is, who are these hackers? Are they uneducated people or the intellectuals from IITs, NITs, IISCs and MITs, is it not? So when there is character taken away from education, what happens is one group of intelligentsia comes out from prestigious institutes and hacks the system, and then another group of intelligentsia comes out from the same institute, develops algorithms to prevent hacking. In this way, we are just whirlpooling in the same place, not going anywhere ahead. That is why Swami made a famous statement. He said, only when the technology of the West and the spirituality of the East, when both of them wed together and combine together, then alone can we have a harmonious society. So this is the goal of Santulan. So we are very happy that all bright students of IIT are coming and taking out your time to learn these things, because one educated person can set the trend for many people, and this is what we want the Indians to do. We are all sitting on a mountain full of gold, which is a wonderful culture, the wisdom in our own ancient scriptures. But sitting on this huge mountain full of gold, we are searching for broken pieces of glasses outside. So if we can try to make a combination of the Western technology with the ancient wisdom of the East, then we can do a lot of good things to the society. And this is what we are hoping that all of you will be able to do in the future and make India a better place and make the world itself a happier place to live in. So without further delay, I would like to go into the topic. The topic for today is the art of public speaking. Recently, there was a study by the Americans. You all know Americans are most known for doing all kinds of research and survey. So they made a survey on what are the 10 things Americans fear the most, and they had the list. And the third greatest fear for the entire America, an average statistics said, is the fear of death. What is the third one? Fear of death. And the second one, which you all will probably agree, is fear of losing a girlfriend. What is the second greatest fear Americans have? Fear of losing a girlfriend. And then the top, the one which was on the top of the list, what can it be? Fear of public speaking. So the topmost fear for every individual is fear of public speaking. I remember a nice story. Once upon a time, there was a villager. He went to the city to learn education and flourish his career. But unfortunately, he could not cope up with the studies. But God had given him a very nice talent. He was a very good orator. But he didn't have the knack of polishing it and giving it the final cosmetic touch to make it appealing to the public. So then a friend of him suggested, why don't you go and attend a seminar which was supposed to be held in the same city by a very expert orator. And then by developing these skills, you can start your own kind of business and make nice money. So then he thought it's a good idea. And he went and attended the session. And sure enough, he was trying to grasp in and drink in each and every word what the orator was speaking, because it was a question of his survival now, is it not? So he was very eager. And then, of course, that orator was known for his amazing way of introduction. So he was very eager to know how the orator is going to introduce the whole talk. So he started off, the orator started off saying, he said, the best days of my life I spent in the hands of a woman who was not my wife. And this was in America. So then all of them were thinking, who is that? Probably another extramarital affair or something. And then what did he say? The best days of my life I spent in the arms of a lady was not my wife, and that lady is my mother. So that was what he said. And this person, the villager, thought it's a very nice beginning. I will also do the same thing. And then he goes to his village and then he starts off in the same way. What does he say? He says, the best days of my life I spent in the arms of a lady who was not my wife. And then because of stage fear, he forgot who that other lady was. And he said, I'm sorry, I don't remember who that lady was. So you understand the same. This is what stage fear can do to us. In fact, there are many lessons which we can learn from this. One lesson what we can also learn is, many times we feel excessive stage fear because in India we have this wonderful way of learning. What is that learning called? It is called mugging up, is it not? So even when we are asked to go for a speech, we have this rote learning or mugging it up. More and more information you store, and at the right time you don't get the information out, you are gone, is it not? So this is one reason why many people have excessive stage fear, because they depend more on their memory, not on understanding and speaking out what they really have realized or what has gone inside. So this is one lesson. And another lesson what we can also learn is, there is a small difference between imitation and following. When we try to imitate others, often we land up putting ourselves in greater trouble, is it not? Because every one of us is unique. No two people can have the same kind of behavior. Somebody may be humorous, but now if we try to fit in, just to imitate that personality, we may often land up making a fool out of ourselves. So there is a small difference between blindly imitating and following in the footsteps. Following in the footsteps means we take the principles from him, but don't blindly imitate. Understanding, I have my own talents, that other person has his own talents, and whatever good I can pick and adapt in myself, I will try to do it. So with that introduction, we will go to the slides. Otherwise, we will go on speaking for a long time.
Yes.
So today, we will proceed this way. First, we'll have a formal, probably, definition of what is communication or what is presentation. And then the second one, we will see some examples of miscommunication. And then the third one is the most important thing. Today we have come here for the topic on art of public speaking. But we have to know why we have to develop this art. What is the outcome or purpose of this? And then we will see on how to improve or what are the factors which can impact our public speaking ability and some tips for overcoming stage fear. And then we will have a triple C formula and a sandwich principle which you can carry home as a message. And finally, conclusion, summary and question and answers. Yes. So these are some basic things. We can just rush through them. We all know that communication can be also categorized into three forms. The first one is a written communication, which is in the modern previous days, it was in the form of letters, but now we have emails, SMS, and many other stuff. And then we have this projector. Then we have voice communication through mobiles, through phones, and other things. And then finally, personal face-to-face communication, is it not? So those are the three levels of communication. And we will see in each of the forms of communication, there is an enormous chance that there can be miscommunication. For example, all of us have this famous, heard this famous joke or whatever the statement. A small change in a comma or an apostrophe can land up into total different meaning, totally different meaning, is it not? Kill. What is it? Kill him, spare him not. Is it not? Kill him not, spare him. A small difference in comma can give completely different meaning. Is it not? Kill him, spare him not. I mean, kill him, don't spare him, or not spare him, or kill him not, then a comma, spare him. It can give a completely different meaning. In the next, and here we'll see, presentation is defined as means to convey ideas in such a way that it is clearly understood to the audience. So a presentation is effective only if you are able to convey the ideas to the audience. The audience should carry home the message.
Is there a problem there? Yes. It's loose, is it? Here, connection.
Anyway, there's a famous joke which recently I googled up and got it. Once upon a time, a wife, she was telling her husband that I need these things very urgently to make a make pastry or cake. And this was the list what she gave. She thought, let me number it up so that the husband will have a checklist and tick mark everything. So she wrote this way: first one, pound of butter; second, bag of icing sugar; third, bottle of vanilla; fourth, dozen bananas; fifth, bag of flour; sixth, large carton of milk. And the husband wanted to finish this fast because he wanted to go for a basketball match to watch it. So then the wife said, it's a very small purchase, please do it quickly. The wife was eagerly waiting, and almost half an hour passed, the husband was not to return. She got tensed. Probably he has gone to watch the basketball match. And then after half an hour, suddenly he opens the door and he comes with huge truckloads or probably huge bags. And then she sees what the husband understood it was, he thought, I have to get 1 pound of butter, 2 bags of icing sugar, 3 bottles of vanilla, 4 dozen bananas, 5 big bags of flour and 6 large cartons of milk. So this is one example where written communication can land up into miscommunication, is it not? So we often see that there are many instances where our intent is right and what we wanted to communicate also we have written it properly, but the way it is written can give a completely different meaning. And another example for miscommunication is a wonderful story. There is a wonderful saying that only an effective listener can become an effective speaker. Do you all get it? Only an effective listener can become an effective speaker. Why? Because if you see, most of the communication in this world is incomplete because of egocentricness. What is the reason for communication to be incomplete? Because the ego comes in between. When the ego is in between, then the communication cannot happen peacefully. One example for such a communication is this story called the lighthouse story. What is the story? Once upon a time, there was a captain of a ship proceeding on a big ship towards the shore. And then on the other side, he saw somebody sending out a light signal. And then the captain thought, it's coming head on. Probably there's another big ship coming. So he sent a signal to the other ship. He said, please take a 20-degree turn. I am captain of this important ship. And then the reply came immediately. It said, I am a low-class servant of the other ship, but I am requesting you take a 20-degree turn. So what the captain said, you take a 20-degree turn. And the reply came, I am a low-class servant, but I am requesting you take a 20-degree turn. And then the captain was annoyed. He said, if you do not take a 20-degree turn now, then I will dismiss you from the post. And then the reply came, even if you dismiss me from the post, I will not take a 20-degree turn because I am not a ship, but I am a lighthouse. What was he communicating to? Who was he communicating to? He was communicating to the lighthouse. What is the moral from this principle, from this small episode? When the ego becomes infatuated, our intelligence shuts off. He could have just asked a question. Although I am a senior captain and you are a normal servant, the very fact that you are adamantly saying you will not be taking a 20-degree turn means there has to be a reason. Can you kindly clarify why you are not able to take a 20-degree turn? That was the only thing which was needed to be asked, is it not? But when the ego comes in front, my God, there is no possibility of communication, is it not? That is why we see most of the group discussions, especially in the famous news channels, never have a final conclusion, is it not? Because they feel that unless my ego is satisfied, they feel that the way to make myself very prominent in the society is to speak with a loud mouth. But they do not understand that listening is equally important. So for us to be very good communicators, we have to listen. Now you may ask a question. In public speaking or in a seminar like this, how do I listen? Because I'm not going to ask any of you to speak now, is it not? Then what kind of listening is there? That listening is called empathy. We all must have heard of this term, is it not? Empathy means we put ourselves in the shoes of the audience. We don't go on speaking. We take a moment and see whether the audience are with me, whether they are able to follow what I'm saying, whether they are liking what I'm speaking, whether it is discouraging to the audience. This is called listening when talking. Are you all able to follow this? So an effective communicator often pays very much attention to how the audience are able to respond to what he's speaking, and he's able to adjust accordingly. That is listening. And then we have another famous example for miscommunication. I will not go into the 77 coffee. We will do one story. The story of four naughty children. This in fact comes in Stephen Covey's book, 8 Habits of Highly Effective Leaders or Speak Leaders. So he says how there can be miscommunication if we have wrong perceptions about somebody. We understand many times when we perceive something wrong about a person, that itself can lead to miscommunication. And one such story he states in his book that once upon a time there was a father with four children sitting on the bus stop, and all these four little children, they were continuously talking, giggling and creating a nuisance and disturbance to the whole of the other people around the bus stop, in the bus stop. And then this Stephen Covey, who was present there, he thought, I should take out little time and tell this father, man, come on, your children are disturbing the whole of the public. You have to take time, take some time out and make them understand what they are doing. So he was waiting for an opportune moment, and then when it became intolerable, the nuisance of the children, he went to that person and he blurted out. He said, do you know what your children are doing? Then he said, yes, I understand. They are all playing around. Why don't you do something about it? I can do something about it, but I do not want to do now because they have just returned from the funeral of their own mother. So this was the thing what he conveyed. And immediately, what happened? All the kinds of perceptions which were present in that present in Stephen Covey about this person immediately changed. That same person for whom he was feeling so much of hate, now the heart suddenly is filled with compassion. He's feeling probably this person is so unlucky, how can I help him? So this is an effective thing. Whenever we want to communicate to others, especially on a one-to-one basis, we have to be very much free from any false perceptions. We have to clarify the things, because a wrong perception can lead to wrong communication also, is it not? The first time he blurted out with anger because of wrong perception, and then after that he repented for himself, is it not? That is why there is a famous saying, tongue has no bones but it can break bones of others, because it can break the heart. So effective communication needs empathic listening. That is the lesson we learn. Yes, now the important question. Why do we have to learn public speaking or communication? There are two ways of looking at it. One is, I want to learn public speaking so that I can get placed in a company, because that is also a part needed. Or I want to learn public speaking so that I can impress the audience. There are many things. So whenever an activity is done, the most important thing is, why am I doing that activity? So why should we learn communication, or why should we learn public speaking? One is, we can mesmerize the crowd with very nice talk. That is also needed, but it is said that is not the ultimate goal for learning communication. Why? Because all of us have learned pen is mightier than the sword, is it not? Which means writing or speech is an effective way to transmit information and transform the hearts of people. Is it not true? we have seen in this world there have been big, big orators, and some of them are probably more skillful than many others. But those people who last forever within the hearts of our, within every one of our hearts, are those orators who have been able to transform the lives of the people in a positive way. Is it not so? We learn communication because we understand speech is a very ideal medium to not just convey information but to transform the lives of people. That is why it is very important that we have to be living what we are speaking. Why do we remember Gandhiji? Because he said, be the change you want to see in this world. So how do we become an effective communicator? An effective communicator can, I mean, we can become an effective communicator or touch the hearts of people only when we strive to practice the principles what we are speaking. Otherwise it is not possible. Imagine somebody comes on Power of Habits and he speaks about the ill effects of smoking, and then after the session he goes and takes a cigarette. How many of us would be inspired to follow or carry home the message what he is speaking? None of us. Is it not true? So it is the best way. That is why the saying is there, more things are caught than taught. Is it not so? If we on a long run want to keep the people on the right track or transform them in a positive way, we have to be striving to follow what we are speaking. That is a place when communication really becomes effective. That is why we remember Martin Luther King and we remember Mahatma Gandhi. And there is also a nice story in the Panchatantra probably. So there the story says, once a mother came to a saintly person and the mother complained to the saintly person, my child is always fond of eating sweets. Please advise him not to eat sweets. And the saint said, very well, it's an easy thing, but please come after 1 month, I will advise. And then the mother waited for 1 month, and then after 1 month she took the child back, and then he came, the child came, and then the saint advised them, please do not eat sweets. And eventually the child stopped eating sweets. But then the mother asked the saint, it's such a simple instruction, you could have given it the very first day. You ask for 1 month of time. And what did the saint reply? He said, I was myself addicted to eating sweets. So first 1 month I practiced in giving up eating sweets, and when I was in a position of not being addicted to sweets, I later on advised the child. So really, if we want to transform the lives of people through our communication, that can be possible when we are trying to sincerely apply whatever things we are speaking in life, in our own lives. Otherwise, for a one-time show, everyone may clap their hands, very nice, we are inspired, but then we can't transform the society. We can't transform our own selves also by the speech what we are giving. So it is very important, like integrity, every company speaks about it, is it not, before they take. So we have to strive to follow what we are speaking, then it will become effective. Yes. Now these are all some statistics. It is said, once you have the content well prepared, which means the content is meaningful, after the content is meaningful and well prepared, then 55% of your presentation is only based on your personality, on whether you are enthusiastically presenting or whether you are not confident about what you are speaking, that way. And 38% is based on voice modulation. How is it said? And then only 7% of the entire seminar depends on what you are speaking. It doesn't mean the content is not important, but once the content is well prepared, even if we miss out one or two important principles, that is not going to be a big effect in the final thing. The most important is how we communicate it, whether we are able to give the proper emphasis for proper things, that is more emphasized. So these are some things which we can quickly go through. Who? The first thing is who, or the personality. What all things come under this? First is physical. How is he whether he is physically lively, active, energetic, or a dynamic speaker or a monotonous, boring speaker. Second one is he has to be enthusiastic. It's also said that one should take proper rest before the talk. At least it is said 1 hour of motivational talk requires around 4 hours of training or 4 hours of practice. We have to actually speak in front of the mirror or within our own mind, we have to visualize the whole thing and at least do it 2-3 times before we actually go and speak. And the next one, as it is said, is enthusiasm. And enthusiasm comes from a, the origin of that is from the word entho, and entho means closer to God. So that is an interesting connection there. And then appropriate attire. When we go for a cultural, it would be nice if we present ourselves in a cultural way and also neatly combed or at least ironed clothes. So appropriate attire and pleasant disposition, a smile and genuine humor, all these things will add to our presentation. So this is the first part. I think it is more or less self-explanatory. The second part is how. So there's a nice example for this. Suppose you have a nice feast or a very nice meal with lot of items, puri, sabji, halwa, gulab jamun, so many items are there. And you have your friends sitting and you want to serve them. But only thing, after bringing all the items in front of them and after you see saliva dripping from their mouth, you realize that you do not have a spoon to serve. Then how is it possible? You have to probably dump the buckets, is it not? Some of them may get a lot, some may get less. So the spoon is very important, is it not? Not just what is there, halwa, gulab jamun, that is important, but the spoon is also important so that everyone gets it very nicely. Similarly, the content is important, but the communication is like the spoon, which can actually transfer the content into the heart of the other person. That is called, that is the example of the spoon. What is voice modulation? I think many of you must have already heard of it. You must have had courses about it. We shouldn't be monotonous in our speech. Let me tell you one nice story. This is a story of Isaac Newton. So there are many ways of telling it. I will tell it in a way and probably with little bit of voice modulation, if you are able to appreciate it, then I think you have got the concept well. So this Isaac Newton, he was a firm believer of God, but he had one atheistic friend who would always argue about the existence of God. And one fine day, Isaac Newton thought, let me put an end to this argument. So what he did was, he prepared a working model of the solar system. In fact, it was a crankshaft mechanism. What was it? A crankshaft mechanism. When he would move the crankshaft, all the planets would revolve in their respective orbits. And then he invited his friend to his home. And as soon as the friend came, the friend said, oh, Isaac, amazing. How wonderful. How were you able to make such a nice working model of the solar system in such a short span of time? And what did Isaac Newton reply? Oh, please do not give any credit to me. I did nothing. Then how did this come about? He said, all what I did was, I brought all the raw materials and intended to make this working model. But then I put it in the corner of a room and went to sleep. And in the midnight, I heard a huge explosion. And when I got up, then I saw the working model was in its place. And what do you think the friend replied? The friend replied, oh, Isaac, how have you learned storytelling so nicely? You can probably go and teach the children. They will be very happy with your stories. But then Isaac Newton was persistent. He said, no, this is exactly how the working model came. A huge explosion occurred. And when I got up, I saw the working model in its place. But later on, the friend said, oh, come on, Isaac. Let's stop playing fun. Let's be scientific. Tell me scientifically. How is it possible? Then Isaac Newton replied. He said, if you are not able to believe that this small working model of the solar system can come from an explosion, then how am I to believe that the actual solar system with so many planets revolving in its orbits, never colliding with each other, never having a traffic jam signal like the Chennai signal, how has that come about by an explosion? And when he said this, the atheist became a theist. That is the story. So here you can see in the story what I just told you, the final message, the argument what Newton said has to be said in a very empathetic, it has to be emphasized and modulated in a very convincing way, is it not? How did I tell it? I asked him saying, for Isaac Newton, I spoke as follows. I said, if you cannot believe that the small working model can come on its own, then how am I to believe that the actual solar system with so many planets revolving in their orbits, never colliding with each other, how can that come about by an explosion, is it not? So that voice modulation makes the message sink in the heart. Or if I would have just told, Isaac said, if this cannot come by explosion, this also cannot come by explosion. He'll say, okay, I got some information. But that hasn't sinked into the heart. You understand? So at the right place when the voice modulation is not there, the message doesn't sink into the heart. Rather, it only remains in the head and we forget it after some time. So that way. And then we have to be very distinct and clear in what we are speaking. We have to complete the words. We should not swallow it. If we are hungry, we can eat nicely and come, but we shouldn't swallow the words what we are speaking. That is a rule. And how do we develop this distinct and clear voice? We have to practice reading loudly. For 30 minutes, I am sure I am not going to say for the next 6 weeks, because we all know what is the determination of all the students here. So at least for the next 6 days, what should we do? If we want to develop distinct and clear voice, we have to read aloud for half an hour, at least for 6 days. And then we have to know the slides. We should know what is in the slide and what is the next slide to come. We should not look at the slide and then start speaking. Rather, we should have a clear flow. And some more things on how to speak. Eye to eye contact. If you want to put a person to sleep in your session, best thing is you don't look at him, because the attention span of every individual is very limited, and he slowly goes to sleep. So the best way to keep the students or anyone awake is continuously keep looking at every one of them, so that he will understand I have to pay attention. So eye to eye contact is very important. And one more very important thing is we have to speak with conviction. We have to choose such a topic which we are ourselves convinced of. We cannot simply take somebody else's topic because it's a nice topic. There's a wonderful story for this also. All of us know Albert Einstein was a very nice speaker, and he would continuously speak on theory of relativity to every scientific conference where he went. And his driver, because Einstein would prepare for the seminar on the car, he would hear Albert Einstein speak so many times that he memorized the entire talk. And then one such day when he went to France for a seminar, he suddenly fell ill and he said, I am not in a position to present today's seminar. And he said, let us cancel the seminar. Then the driver said, what are you going to speak about? Is it the same old theory of relativity? Yes, he said. Then he said, no worries. Anyway, French people have never seen you. Those days there was no Facebook, camera, all those. So they have never seen you. I can dress myself in a way similar to you, and I will do the talk. And Einstein said, come on man, you are a chauffeur, I am a Nobel laureate. How can you speak on such high level concepts? And then he said, no, nothing to worry. I have been hearing you so many times. If you want, I can do a demo here. Okay. And then he gave the entire talk. And Einstein was stunned. He spoke as good as Einstein. And then he said, okay, you have all my blessings. You can go for the seminar. And Einstein took the driver's seat and he went there. And then when he got out, he got out of the car, he entered the seminar hall, standing ovation, garlands, many other things. Of course, no garlands. In India, we have garlands. There you don't have that. So many people respected him, and then he spoke. And then finally, he asked, he concluded it, and then a scientist raised his hand, said, "I have a question." Now he was not prepared for this, because he, Albert Einstein, does not speak about the question answers during the car rehearsal, because he also doesn't know what questions to expect. So suddenly he asked a question, and the question itself went for 2 minutes. And this person was clueless what he's speaking about. But then somehow he prayed to God intensely, and he got the right presence of mind. And then he gave a big laugh. "Ha! Such a simple question. Even my driver can answer this. Hey, call that driver." And then who was the driver? Albert Einstein. So, of course, he answered it. But that kind of situation will not happen to us always. We should remember that. Which means, we should go and speak on such topics which we are confident about. Half knowledge is going to be a disaster, is it not? So, we have to select such a topic where we are convinced about, so that we can convey to the audience in an effective manner. And then some other things are, some people have the habit of moving too much. It is generally advised that we stay with little bit of movement, so that the audience is also able to focus and we can also be able to focus on the audience. And then it is said, do not stand behind the podium, make yourself present before the audience so that they can see you, interact with you. And these are all some of the steps on how to deliver a public speech. And then what to deliver, this you will again see as a revision in the end. What means the content? Generally, the content should have three parts. One is the introduction, next is the subject or the body, and the final is the conclusion. In the introduction, what should generally take place is we should say what we are going to say, or what is the outline of the whole talk. And we all know this common saying, first impression is the best impression. So it will be good if we can start off, if we can start off with some story, some humor, something like that. All of you remember what was the story I started off with? The best days of my life I spent in the hands of a lady who was not my wife. So that was the story we started off, is it not? So after the introduction, in the introduction you are telling the audience what I intend to say. Then in the subject, you are actually saying what you want to say. And then finally in the conclusion, because audience in the modern time, the external memory is increasing, 32 GB pen drive, 64 GB pen drive, but this internal memory is gone. So in the end, as a routine, what one is supposed to do is he has to summarize. So first you have to say what you want to say, then you have to actually say, then in the end you should say what I said, so that they take home the message. So this is a way when a speech can be remembered by the audience, they can take home something valuable. And we have here an opening technique to attract favorable attention of audience. The first 30 to 60 seconds is important, and because the audience decides in these moments whether they want to listen to you or not. Hence start with quotations, humors, humor, anecdotes, incidents, stories, etc. And what to speak? What to speak is a broad subject. The content can be in different formats, but research says that because of our brain, the left portion of the brain is more of intellectual and the right portion of the brain is more emotional, an ideal talk will have little bit of statistics and little bit of emotions. Statistics is also needed because the crowd may be varied. So some statistics is needed, but along with statistics, there has to be emotions or creativity like stories, etc. That is what to speak. And finally, ending. Ending we have to summarize. Build to a climax and close. We have the KISS formula. Keep it short and simple. That is the formula. Yes. Now the most important part. How to get rid of stage fright. What are the causes of stage fright? We will see first. Causes are because it's natural for everyone, and we feel a great fear of failure, is it not? And we have never heard ourselves speaking with our voice raised in front of a public, and for the first time we are doing it, so probably it's a new situation for all of us. And then the last reason is because everyone is looking at you. You are the center of the whole crowd. You don't want to make a fool out of yourself. So these are some of the causes. Subconscious fear of mob, yes. And how do we overcome it? First is we prepare thoroughly. There is no substitute to repeated practice. Once you prepare nicely, then there will not be much fear to speak in public. Prepare thoroughly. Recognize that you are not alone suffering from stage fear. Everyone is going to suffer. Accept the fact that your audience wants you to succeed and not fail. This is a very important question. Whenever we go for any seminar, the audience comes to the seminar to see us speaking in a very nice way, is it not? Do the audience want us to become a failure? They do not want to give their time to attend a seminar which is not going to give them something, is it not? So we have to understand the audience wants us to succeed. They are not our enemies, rather they are our well-wishers. Understand that with experience, your stage fear will be reduced. Remember that there will always be a next time. And the last step is one has to know the audience. Knowing the audience means understanding what is their educational background, what is their interest, what is their attitude towards the topic what we are speaking, and what is your attitude towards them, and all those things comes under knowing the audience. This is also important. How many will be there in the audience? Once we know it, mentally we can prepare ourselves. We can imagine that I'll be speaking to this many people and mentally prepare ourselves. What is the age of your audience? Yes. If it's a very youthful group, one can crack many jokes. And if it's a very educated class of people, we also give lot of statistics. Whether it's only a male population, it's a mixed crowd. What is their educational background? Because if you are speaking on scientific topics and we are inviting PhDs, then we better be very careful, because anything what we are presenting, they are going to know in and out of it, is it not? So we have to know the educational background of the people who are coming. What is their cultural background? Economic status? And what is the attitude of the audience towards you as a speaker? And what is their attitude towards the proposed topic? The knowledge of your audience on the subject of your talk. And the last one is, we have to know what are the types of people who are going to attend. There's a formula, the dress formula. There are generally four kinds of people. One is the directive people. Directive people are like managers who are going to make the decisions. And reflective people is the R. R stands for reflective people. Reflective people means those people who often question a lot. They are intellectual or scientific. So for the managers, what has to be presented is, we have to give a clear roadmap saying, how if this is implemented, this can lead to success. Because they are going to make decisions. Unless you convince them that this roadmap will take them here, they are not going to listen to it. And for the reflective people, unless you show them by statistics, previously somebody has done it and it has become successful, or you show them through logic and reason, they are not going to listen to it. And then there are other categories of people who are emotional people. Emotional people come for a seminar and they are not expecting much of logic, nor are they expecting any decision to be taken, but they want something to touch their emotions. And for them, we need to tell a lot of stories and lot of other anecdotes to make them understand the subject matter. And the last one is called supportive people. Supportive people means these people often are fearful. They are like the group 1 and group 2 employees, the lowest level of employees. When they come for any seminar, they often look for shelter. they feel when the speech is given, probably they should not fire me from the industry. I am talking from an industry perspective. Suppose a new policy is to be announced. There are a board of directors or managers here, and you are presenting it to the entire company. Here are the people who are making the decision. When you present it to them, we have to be very crystal clear on the pros and cons. The SWOT analysis, which you will learn probably, strength, weaknesses, opportunities and threats. All these things, when we present it in a nice way, then the managers are convinced. And then the reflective people who are the intellectuals in the company, for them we have to give a lot of statistics. We have to speak through science, through logic, how this decision is going to benefit on a long term basis. And then for the emotional people, they are more of just wanting some comfort through words. And for the supportive people, they want security. They want to be ensured that they are still safe being in the company with any new decision taken. So based on the kind of audience we speak to, our same subject matter has to be put in a slightly different manner. And then the last part, skills for improving public speaking. We have already spoken this, it is again a revision kind. The first one is called triple C formula, and the second one is called the sandwich principle. The triple C formula is conceive, contemplate and communicate. We have already spoken these things. I am just giving new terms to it, that's it. So that you remember, okay, I learned the triple C formula. What is it? Conceive, contemplate and communicate. What is conceive? Conceive is again being empathetic or understanding the needs, interests and concerns of the audience. The same subject matter can be addressed in a different way to different people. For example, meditation is a topic. Now if I am going to speak to a crowd of first year engineers, I am going to tell them how by doing meditation your concentration will improve, is it not? Because for them the need, interest and concern is their studies. So I have to address that first, correct? Although meditation can do so many other things, but for a student, for a first year student when he is coming here, his only goal is how is this going to help me to get a better grade. So then for them we speak about meditation as concentration, is it not? Now if I go to a person working in the corporate, how do I speak about the same meditation? Would any like of stress management? It is the same meditation. Now for a student, I addressed his need. What was it? Concentration. And the same meditation, but for a software professional, I put it in a term where he will be able to appreciate it. This is not any manipulation, rather when we touch the needs and interests of the people, they will accept it positively. This is not a marketing technique, but when something is valuable, we have to present it in a way that he'll be able to accept it. So for a corporate person, what should I say? I will say stress management. Now if I go to a housewife who has a small child, how will I tell about meditation? I will say that what you do in life, your child is going to follow the same, is it not? Every one of us want children to be Mahatmas. For that, first we also have to learn to be at least a small Mahatma, is it not? So more things are caught than taught. So then the parent will think, yes, it is very important. Before I tell the child, I myself have to follow. So it is the same meditation, but based on the needs of every individual, we can give it at different terms, in different terms. Are you able to appreciate? The same topic, you need not change the topic, but we should know how this is going to impact that person and be able to show it to him. Then he will accept it very easily. So that is conceive. We have to think about what the audience is looking for and then present it accordingly. And then contemplate. Contemplate is, you have to contemplate on the topic. Look for relevant examples, look for connecting stories, Like now, if I ask you all to recollect from the seminar, what story did you learn? What story did I narrate to show that you should not go with half knowledge? What was the story we discussed? Albert Einstein, is it not? So this is contemplation. When I was preparing for the seminar, I thought that I want to drive this point home, but to drive this point home, they will be able to take it only if I tell a connecting story. So then I had to prepare for a connecting story. Now you will be able to understand. Let me not go with half preparation, otherwise I will become like the driver and I may not have Einstein as my car driver. So that way. And then final is what? Communicate. After contemplating, after getting the flow of the seminar very clear, then we actually communicate to the audience. And how does effective communication come? By repeated practice. By repeated practice, one will be able to communicate well. And then the last one, triple C is done. Now the sandwich principle. This we already discussed. It's a revision again. Sandwich, we all know that in a sandwich, the essence is in the middle, but the above and below are just layers. The nutrition is in the middle. Same way, the message is in the middle, but to keep it very nicely in the minds of the audience, we begin nicely and conclude nicely. So you can see here, begin in an entertaining way so that the audience is eager to listen to you. Then in the middle, inform them what you want to inform. Because only when the hearts open up can we actually put something within their hearts. So in the middle you inform them, touch their heart, and the final conclusion should be call for action and revision of what we already informed them. So that completes the entire speech. We begin with an entertaining way, give the substance in middle and conclude. And with this I also conclude my talk. So we'll just summarize what we went through. The most important goal of today's seminar, why to learn public speaking, was not for information transmission but for heart transformation. We want that all of us develop this quality so that with a powerful medium of speech, we can be able to touch people's lives in a positive way. And when is it possible for us to touch a person's life in a positive way? When we ourselves are trying to follow what we are speaking. So that is the goal of today's seminar. And we saw some examples of miscommunication. Can you all recollect what examples we saw for miscommunication? The wife wrote a list of all the things to be purchased, is it not? But he took it as 1 pound of so much, 2 pounds, 4 dozens of bananas, so and so on and so forth. Something else we saw? Comma, we saw that comma in the SMS, then lighthouse story. What lesson did we learn from there? When the ego comes in between, there is no communication possible. One may be because of language defect, but the more problem occurs because of ego. And then we saw 3 impacting factors, who, how and what. In who, we saw that the personality who is presenting has to be enthusiastic, dynamic, and has to come in a neat attire. And in how, we saw voice modulation. There we narrated a story. All of you can recollect the story for voice modulation. Isaac Newton's story we discussed, is it not? The same conclusion, if said in an emphatic way, it can bring a very nice, it can help the person sink the message into his heart that way. And then overcoming stage fear. What all did we see in overcoming stage fear? I did not elaborate much. Can you all recollect some of the points? Come well prepared. Then know that everyone else is suffering from stage fear. By practice it will go away. And then the audience wants you to succeed. We should be convinced that the audience are not our enemies, but they are our well-wishers. They have come out here spending their time to hear from me and appreciate my talk. So they are not critical about me, rather they are well-wishers. And then knowing the audience, what is the age group, what is the background, whether they are appreciative to the topic, all that will help. And then finally we saw triple C formula. What does triple C stand for? Conceive, contemplate, communicate. Yes. And then the sandwich principle. So with this I end my talk. Thank you very much for your patient hearing. Thank you very much. And again, if you found anything good in this talk, it is only a credit to all my seniors who have been guiding me for the years to come. I mean, for last 7 years, and for the future also, they are my constant guides. And if you did find something inappropriate, it is because of my own shortcomings. Please forgive me if that was the case. And again, I would like to extremely be grateful and thankful for giving your time. If you have one or two questions, we will take it. After that, we can disperse. Yes.
Is there any way you can you can remember that, sir? Like the.
So we have to do it in the mind. At least first 2-3 times, you have to do it in the mind. Visualize. You are speaking to the audience, and you expect the response from the audience. I did this 3-4 times today before doing it. I went and sat, and then I imagined I'll start like this. Then the audience will smile. Then I will put this point. Then after that, I will say this. And when you do it repeatedly, 2-3 times, that's why it said 1 hour of talk means 4 hours of practice. But as you go on speaking, it becomes more and more easy in that way. First time when I did, it was tough. But now, as you go on doing, but you have to mentally visualize the crowd. That is the best way. You sit mentally, imagine you're sitting, and all the expressions you can keep in your mind. I want to say this way, that way. You will be able to recollect. Yes. Any other question? Yes. Thank you. Sir,
one small announcement. Please give your feedback forms filled, because it is very important to us if you are at all are leaving. So,
what about this extempore talks?
Extempore, okay. So, good question. Extempore, as per my humble suggestion, that if suppose a talk comes out where we are not much informed, I would take a safe stand of saying that I am informed of this talk. So much and so, but always very good question is, we have to have a set of 10 to 15 stories or 10 to 15 anecdotes which should always be ringing in the mind. If anybody says a topic, those 10 to 15 stories, if you are able to connect to a particular talk, that will add. Like for example, I will tell you the same story today, what I spoke about, that I spent the best days of my life in the hands of a lady who was not my wife, that I spoke as stage fear. But what other topics can I speak the same thing for? I can speak it for blind imitation or following without realization or just blindly mugging up and trying to speak. So like that, one story, if we can try to apply it at many places. So all what we need to know is 10 to 15 stories where any talk comes, we try to fit in and give a lesson corresponding to that topic. So that is how I myself prepare for extempore. So I have 10 stories or 15 stories with me and stock. If somebody asks for a talk, I'll try to fit in this one of the things there.
So. Yes, suppose if you make a mistake, I mean, when you're speaking, how do you really come out of that if you find that the people are not interested? And you want to come out of it, and again, you want to really energize them. How do you do that?
The best way is you crack a joke in between or you tell a story. Because once the audience loses their interest, best way to bring them back is to crack a joke in between. Or try to tell a story. Or try to make them think about something. But they'll not be in a position to think. So best is try to crack a joke in between.
Very good evening, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, when you are presenting, someone is keep on asking the questions, then how can you manage this thing?
Yes. So we have to be very clear. When we are speaking, if we find that the question is a genuine question, we answer it. But if that person is asking for the sake of interrupting or for the sake of drawing the attention of the audience or for the sake of embarrassing the speaker, then what we should do is, we should humbly say, at the end, I will take all your questions, because then the flow may get interrupted. And then he will ask in the end. And in the end also, when somebody is asking a question, if you are speaking a talk which is going to touch the hearts of people in a nice way. But there is one person who wants to distract the crowd. Then what we should do? We should take him personally and answer the question. Why? Because if you get into an argument with that person and hundreds of people are watching it, is it not? Now, although they were convinced of it, now this one person can maybe take all what you have done out, is it not? So you can take him personally, because there will be some people, you know this famous saying, right? He who is convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. Can you repeat it? What is it? He who is convinced against his will is of the same opinion still. There are some people who are broad-minded and open-minded and open-hearted. They want to learn new things. But some people have already decided, I have come here only to refute the speaker. I am not going to hear at all from him. Such people can take the audience out. In such a case, we have to win the trust of the audience. We can be very polite to him. And in the end, you can take him personally and try to clarify. If he's still convinced I'm not going to change, leave him. That's it. Thank you. Yes.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening.
So my question is that sometimes I face a situation when I'm speaking to some audience and I go out of sentence or out of words, or I couldn't frame my sentence grammatically correct or something, or I think like while speaking I'm not putting those like kind of words which I should use. So how to overcome that?
One thing would be best practices when we speak amongst friends, it will be nice if we can speak more in English. Generally the easiest way to improve our grammar is in our local communication with our friends, put English as the primary language. As much as possible, if you are preparing at least, you may want to speak in your mother tongue, that is nice, but if you are serious about improving it, at least one or two friends you can choose who are very close to you, and you can tell them, I'll try talking in English at least for next 1 month, and if you find something grammatically not so correct, please correct me. So you prepare yourself before the thing, and regularly you talk in English, that will help you.
Any more questions? Okay.
Okay. So thank you very much. Also, I would like to seek the blessings of the seniors here who are seated. They are much more experienced, knowledgeable. Still, they humbly sat for the whole presentation. Thank you, sir, for the kind.
So let's thank today's speaker, Mr. Harish PK, for his inspiring and wonderful talk on the topic, the art of public speaking. We are very grateful to you, sir, for taking out so much time. And he has come from Bangalore. And second time, he's giving a talk from our club, through our club. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir.
Thank you. Yes.
I would also like to thank all the students and professors who have taken out their time for attending this talk and hence encouraging us in your own way. Particularly, I would like to thank Professor B.V. SSS Prasad, Professor K. Srinivasan, and Professor M.P. Maya. I would also like to thank Mr. Jagan from CC for video recording, and Mr. Suresh, who is a logistics operator at CLT. I would also like to thank all the members, club members, who have contributed a lot for organizing this talk. Mr. Anuj, Mr. Anupam, Mr. Sesh Sai, and Mr. Murli Krishna. Yeah, I would request Professor BVS, BVS SSS Prasad to hand over memento to our speaker.